Good afternoon, everyone. I'm William Brangham at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you for joining us for this live stream. We're talking, as we always are, about coronavirus. Today, we're talking specifically about all of the things that need to be in place before we can feel confident about reopening. Obviously, the economy has been horribly damaged by shutting the nation down in many places. And states are starting now to say, okay, enough, we have to try to get our economy going again. But that is a fraught and a risky proposition in cases. And joining us today is Dr. Ashish Jha. He is the head of the Harvard's Global Health Institute. Dr. Jha, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me on.
So we wanted to talk, you study public health and have been looking at many of the different metrics that states have been looking at as well, governors and mayors, to try to figure out what are the best things before we can say, yes, let's let a business reopen. Let's get these buses running again. Let's perhaps let schools go open again. Could you just give us a sense of when you look at what's happening in the country right now, there's a lot of different states doing a lot of different things. What is your sense about, do you think for the most part, and again, this is a generalization, do you think that people are acting smartly right now? Do you think we are there things that frighten you or things that gratify you when you look at what's happening?
Yeah, so William, you know, it's we have a big country and there's a lot of different things happening across the nation. And when I think about what needs to be happening, I actually go back to the White House's Opening Up America Again plan, which, you know, I quibble with some of the aspects of it, but generally the principles are right. 14 days of declining cases, adequate testing and tracing infrastructure, and then you open up slowly. And so if you say, well, how, you know, how widely does that apply in America? What you find is there are clearly states that are meeting that, states with very low number of cases, states like Montana and Wyoming and places that are small in terms of population. Are there other states that have had big outbreaks that are opening very, very slowly, the New Yorks, Massachusetts? There are places I worry, right? I've been very worried about Georgia. They opened early with a lot of cases. And it seems at least 2+ weeks in that they haven't seen a surge, and that's great. Texas has opened, and they are seeing rising number of cases. So what I suspect is going to happen is over the next couple of weeks, the picture will become clearer. Some places probably moved too fast. Others did it prudently. And we'll know a lot more as the effects of these movements become more apparent.
We would like everyone who has questions about this, it can... Ashish knows an enormous amount about this topic. He is really, as I was saying to him before we began, he is a man made for this moment. He is smart and surveyed the landscape of what is going on. So if you have questions, please put them in the comments below, tweet them to us. Just send us those questions when you can. And we would love to get to as many of them as we possibly can in the time we have. Ashish, we're just going to jump into the first question right here. Kaylee Bringdahl on Facebook asks, I work in a childcare facility and I have asthma. I live with my parents, both of whom are severely compromised. I love and miss my kids, but I am very anxious about going back to work. Should childcare centers open while schools remain closed? This is obviously an enormous issue. What's your take on that?
Yeah, and it's a very complicated question, partly because we don't have great data on kids, and we don't have great data on how much kids are susceptible to the infection. We know kids can be infected, of course, but we think the rates of infection are lower in kids, but we're not sure. We don't know that much about how transmittable kind of infections from them are to adults. So part of what I want to do is try to spend the next couple of months really trying to learn all of that, because it'll be critical as we think about opening up schools for the fall. To your specific question, it's a very difficult one. I don't know that asthma puts you at substantially higher risk of complications yourself, but that said, picking up the infection and then bringing it home to your elderly parents, that is a real risk and you have to be very careful. So no easy advice on that, but I think this is an...
Looks like we lost Ashish there for just a moment. Yes, this issue of the question that the viewer had been asking was, can I, as someone who has some immunocompromised parents at home...
A lot of us have to put a lot more attention in. Can you hear me?
Right. Yep, I can hear you now.
Okay. Yeah, sorry.
That's quite all right. Everyone now is working in this Skype new pandemic world. Everyone is used to glitches in the matrix occasionally. Weston Abney on Facebook was asking, what happens when employers demand that employees return to work full time before childcare centers reopen. I mean, we've only seen a few instances of this, but there are people who, by dint of their employment circumstance, might be forced to work or risk losing their jobs, which many people can't afford to do. How do we weigh that as a society, asking people to come back when they still have children at home that need to be cared for by someone?
Yeah, so this is a public policy problem that we have to solve, right? And this will become, I think, even more acute if we go into the fall and many schools don't open or end up shutting down early. And there are no easy answers. And my general take is we shouldn't force people to choose between their jobs and their kids or their jobs and their own life. And so we have to offer people a third choice. And from a policy point of view, that might mean either a job protection or ways of being able to get financial support if you can't continue that job. And I don't have a simple policy answer. I would say it's really, really important that we give people more choices on this, because the choice that this person is facing is obviously very difficult.
Yes. For those of you who are just joining us, I'm here with Dr. Ashish Jha from Harvard's Global Health Institute. And we're talking about the benchmarks that we need to hit so that people can feel safe about reopening of their state, of their city, of their schools, and trying to get the economy going again. But always knowing that there is a virus that is lurking out there, and we still don't have a very good handle on how many cases are out there. And so this is what people are weighing constantly in governments and in families across the nation. Please keep putting your questions below. We'll try to get to as many of those as we can. Edward on Facebook is asking, why test only those with symptoms? Why not a widespread testing of the population to be considered in opening up of cities and states?
Yeah, so we've done a lot of thinking and work on this. We do think you should be actually testing a much wider group of people. You know, what we did was, because our testing capacity was so incredibly limited in March and April, that we were only testing the sickest patients, the people with the most severe symptoms. And that means we were probably missing 80, 90% of the cases. I still think we're missing a vast majority of the cases that are out there, and we need a broad testing strategy. You can't test everybody, so there's got to come up with a whole strategy for finding asymptomatic patients. But we have to move well beyond what we're doing right now, and testing probably in the order of a million or many, more than a million patients a day or people a day.
I'd like to put up one of these facts that our colleagues at USA Facts have drawn up for us. This just gives a good snapshot of the landscape of where we are right now. 92,000 people have died in the U.S. from COVID-19 as of May 21st. That's about 1.5 million cases. And to your point about tests, to date, we seem to have done about 12,600,000 tests so far. But as you're saying, if we're possibly needing to be close to a million a day, those numbers are really going to have to go up before we get a better sense of the landscape of what's going on out here. Dominic on Facebook is asking, how do you know which data is accurate as a basis to implement phased reopening with so much misinformation? Obviously, this is a hugely important thing. You really do, as a governor or a mayor, have to know how many people are infected, where are they, who are they? And that is something we're still a little bit blind to. So how do you wrestle with that?
Yeah, so this is really the job of departments of health of every state, but with the aid and expertise and guidance and resources of the CDC. That's how we're supposed to be able to track this stuff, that every state should know who's been tested, what the results are, who's been hospitalized, who's died, and all of those data points should be feeding into the governor's decision making. But how you collect that data has got to be standardized and done in a valid way, and the CDC is supposed to be helping states do that. The CDC has been pretty variable in its help in this pandemic, which is really puzzling to us because it's such a great public health agency. So that's why there have been problems, I think, with data. But that's generally how this is supposed to work.
And obviously, to your point, I think it is everyone recognizes that we should be doing a lot more testing. But because of early missteps out of the CDC with their particular test, the supply chain problems, just the basic implementation of a real testing regimen has sort of hobbled this response. Tim O'Donnell on YouTube asks, what sorts of treatment have been developed? Are things improving on that front? I'd feel better about exposing myself to the virus if treatments were available, if I got it.
Yeah, so we have had some progress on treatments. The main one is remdesivir. That's an antiviral that was developed by Gilead. And the only place where it's been shown to be effective is in really severely ill people. So right now, we don't have a therapy. If you got infected tomorrow, we don't have a clear therapy that's going to help you from getting sick. Remdesivir may end up being useful. There's a lot of other work being done. But right now, I would say we have only one drug in our armamentarium, and many more are being tested. My hope is in the next few months, we'll know more what else works.
A lot of people have been asking, and I'm going to paraphrase this, a group of questions that people have been wondering about, which is, are there instances where testing is mandatory? Are there places, workers, environments where people are required to get a test as a circumstance of going back to work or doing their jobs?
Yeah, so one place, one context in which testing has been mandatory or certainly pretty pretty commonly employed is in the healthcare setting. Doctors and nurses, especially those who are working with patients who have COVID, are getting tested on an ongoing basis. My personal feeling is that healthcare workers in nursing homes should be getting tested on an ongoing basis. Probably people working in meatpacking plants or other high-risk prisons. All of them should be getting tested on an ongoing basis as a part of their job to keep them safe and to keep the people they work with safe.
We got another question here on Twitter. Someone is asking, I'm going to paraphrase this a little bit, which is, for states like mine, Virginia, where data is suspect because of massaging or selective disclosure, what would you suggest governors and health department officials do to restore trust in the testing and analysis of the resulting COVID-19 data? I should also mention, too, you were quoted in a story recently in the Atlantic magazine about this revelation that the CDC was seemingly to combining viral testing numbers with antibody testing numbers, which are really putting apples and oranges in the same pot and calling them all apples or calling them all oranges. So there is this ongoing question about, can you rely on this data? What would, to answer this viewer's question, what would you do to have governors and public health officials to reassure people that they can trust the information they're hearing?
Yeah, this, by the way, I just recently found out that there are states that are mixing testing for the virus with testing for antibodies, totally different tests with completely different interpretations, and mixing them makes both of them uninterpretable. Then you have no idea how much virus testing you're doing, how much immunity testing you're doing, and what the results are. So states absolutely should not be doing this. If I were the governor of Virginia, I would work with my Secretary of Health and the Department of Health to make sure that we separated out the data, we explained to people why that mix-up had happened, and then reassure people that will never happen again. That's got to be the strategy. And that should be happening in every state across the country right now.
It really was striking to see that the CDC really didn't have a terribly good explanation as to why that was occurring, whether that was intentional or a mistake, or again, unsettling to see that kind of thing happening. Michelle Hart is asking, are states expecting to follow the detailed CDC guidelines? As far as we know, there is no, a governor has authority to open as they see fit, right?
They do, but what governors are looking for is actually technical guidance and expertise, because obviously they want to get it right. Most governors, actually I think all governors want to get it right. And so the detailed CDC guidelines, which were initially shelved by the White House, and then the CDC released a 6-page sort of vague, not very useful document. But then just a couple of days ago, CDC put up the detailed guidelines again on its website. That is useful, the detailed guidelines. And I expect most states will take it, will maybe make some minor modifications to suit their kind of local needs. But that's usually the role CDC plays, is helping with very detailed information to governors. Ultimately, it's a governor's decision, but most governors are pretty happy to get that advice.
Someone is asking about the different types of tests. I think everyone by now has seen on the news the images of that long nasal swab going up into people's heads and the obvious discomfort that the testee has in that case. Someone is asking about these new saliva tests. Kathy on Facebook says, about testing, I recently heard that there will be an easier form of testing by testing saliva. Will that test be available soon?
Yeah. So I'm hoping the answer, short answer is yes. What we're learning is that saliva tests, and again, depending on how you get the saliva, but may be as good as the nasopharyngeal. And if that's true, then you don't need a swab or you may need a different kind of collection method and certainly be a lot more comfortable. So I would say that the science isn't totally there yet and we're working on it, but over the upcoming couple of weeks, we should have a lot more clarity on this issue. And my hope is we'll end up with tests that are much easier to administer, like saliva tests.
When you mentioned this issue about depends on where you collect the saliva, because you're just trying to get an accurate and generalized sense of, does the virus exist in the person who is giving this test? And does at any given moment, a small sample of my saliva give an accurate picture of what's going on in my body, right? That's the issue there.
That's the issue. And what you want to know is you can take people who you know are infected, and people have been doing these studies where they say, you know, if I put a swab up your nose into your throat, how likely am I to pick up the virus that I know is there versus if I do a throat swab or if I just have you produce some saliva. So we're still working out the kind of the best mechanism, because what we care about is making sure we don't have false negatives. We don't want to tell people that they're fine, they don't have the virus when they do. And so we're trying to figure out what collection method gives us the lowest false negative rate.
Right. We were talking before about the mixing of viral testing, which is what we're talking about here, and antibody testing, which is testing after the fact. Whether or not you have developed some of the what is hoped to be a protection against future infection. Tim O'Donnell on YouTube asks, when might we have an understanding as to whether recovering from the virus grants some form of immunity? How long and how much data do we need to get a clear answer to this question?
It's a fabulous question. It's a really important one, both from a population health, individual health point of view. You know, this is one where our knowledge has changed a lot in the last month. A month ago, I would have said, I honestly don't know. I don't know if everybody produces antibodies, and I really don't know if those antibodies are protective. Right now, what the best data suggests is that almost everybody does produce antibodies, and that's great. And that means if you get the infection and you clear it, you should have antibodies. And more evidence suggests that those antibodies really should be protective. Am I 100% sure? No. And we're going to know more in the next couple of months as we do studies where we look at people getting re-exposed. But those are hard studies to do. You could, of course, go and expose people deliberately, but there's some ethical issues there. So we're not going to likely do those studies anytime soon. But there are studies being done. And I think in the next couple of months, we'll go from being pretty sure to really sure. And then the question is, how long does immunity last? And, you know, we've only known about this virus for about 5 months, so we don't have any long-term studies. I suspect the immunity is going to last 12 to 18 months, maybe longer. But as long as it's 12 to 18 months, that's probably good enough to get us to a vaccine.
Right. Good enough to get us to a vaccine is right. Vince on Facebook asks a question related to this. What is the current knowledge about the use of antibodies to fight COVID-19?
Yeah, this is one where I am actually very enthusiastic that this will end up being an important modality for therapy. Do I know for sure? I don't know for sure. But we've seen studies with convalescent plasma, where you take plasma of somebody who's recovered and give it to a sick patient. And we've seen pretty impressive recovery. Again, not randomized trials, but case series. And right now, what people are doing is developing monoclonal antibodies, really essentially figuring out the antibody to the spike protein of the virus. That's the kind of key thing to target. And then giving people that antibody. I suspect we're probably a couple of months away, 2-3 months away from a time period where we have enough evidence to start using it on a regular basis.
We have been getting a series of questions. Obviously, these are people who are thinking about, okay, things are reopening. I might be back in an office. I might be back in the store. A lot of questions about airflow, interestingly. Donna, Susan Sternberg, and several others were asking questions. I'll give you Donna's question. You'll get a sense of what people are curious about. How can a small shop owner make sure the airflow in their shop is as efficient as possible to assure any virus in the air from a customer is removed quickly?
Yeah, so there are people who have real expertise on this in much more than I do. there are experts who spend their lives thinking about air ventilation. And when I've been talking to them, I mean, here are a couple of thoughts. I mean, first of all, I think in any shop, any indoor space, people should be wearing masks because that'll automatically dramatically lower the amount of virus that there is. So that's pretty critical. Second is what we just know is any kind of ventilation. So if you can keep the door open, if you can keep windows open, that help a lot. There are a lot of filters that people are, and even what I've heard from some experts is even some of those HEPA filter machines, if they're the right kind with the right level of filtration, can be an aid. Again, no one thinks that that alone is going to be the solution. So there are people who are experts on this and articles on this that are being written about how best to ventilate. And I would consult them or consult somebody who really is an expert in this area. But it's an important thing to focus on if you're a business owner.
Because my understanding is that we're looking at the concentration of virus particles in the air, and anything that you can do to either dilute that by getting fresh air in or having air circulating from outside in helps reduce the likelihood that one or multiple virus particles will get into your system. Is that right? That's the idea there behind having circulation and better airflow.
Yeah, and there are two other kind of nuances here. One is, you do need a certain amount of virus to get infected. So if you bring it to a low enough level, you may not be able to get infected. And that's obviously what you want. The second is that there is emerging evidence that if the inoculum size, how much virus you get in on that initial inhalation, ends up not just affecting whether you get infected, but how sick you get. And so there's some evidence that if you have a very small inoculum, you might get infected, but you may not get very, very sick. And obviously that would be great, which is one of the reasons we've seen a lot of doctors and nurses get so sick and die from the virus, is because they've been exposed to a large quantity of the virus. So anything you can do to lower the quantity of the virus can end up not just preventing infections, but potentially preventing death.
I think that's so interesting because people think in some ways of, they see this graphic rendering of the coronavirus virus itself and that little spiky ball. And they think, oh, if one of those slips into my mask, I'm in trouble. But no, as you're saying, it's really the quantity and the volume of the virus that you take in that your body might be able to handle a few of those and defeat them. I want to touch on one thing that hasn't come up in the questions yet, but this is a study that we saw coming out of Columbia that was talking about the belief, the modeling that showed that if social distancing and a lockdown had happened earlier than it did in New York, that tens of thousands of lives might have been saved. I know there's been a lot of question and controversy over models, and some people look at them and think that they're unrealistic and they serve to scare a lot of people. Many others in your field look at them and think of them as the best that we can do to understand how things move and how these epidemics unfold. Can you tell us a little bit, what is your take on that? What do you think about that Columbia study?
Yeah, so I think, first of all, I think models have generally been right. They've been helpful to us. I mean, no model gets anything completely right. You know, the old phrase of every model is wrong, but some models are useful. And we've had a lot of useful models in this outbreak. And so I want to defend a lot of those modelers who I think have done a good job. There is no doubt in my mind that the delays in shutting down New York had a profound impact on how many people died. And I do believe that even if we had gone a week or two earlier, it would have made a big difference. This is the entire point of exponential growth in outbreaks like this. If you think of a doubling time of 5 days, it means that by delaying by 10 days, you had four times the number of cases, four times the number of deaths. Or if we had closed 10 days earlier, we would have had a quarter of the deaths that we ended up having. So this is why early action in outbreaks is so incredibly important, because it has a profound impact on how many lives you save.
Of course, we know at the time that they were talking about that. I mean, this is to this day now, this reopening debate is the same as the closing down debate, is that mayors, governors, city officials were weighing, I understand what the public health officials are telling me, but you are talking about taking an enormous economic hit and delivering a potentially mortal blow to numerous businesses and families' economics. If you ask me to do this, and do I pull the lever this week, next week, the week after? And to your exact point, there might certainly have been lives saved, but we know those were wrenching decisions for a lot of mayors and governors to be going through. A couple of more questions before we have to let you go. Paula on Facebook asks, what is your recommendation about flying?
About flying? So I think airplanes are pretty safe in terms of coronavirus and other ways too, of course. They're pretty safe. You know, the issues actually in my mind are more about airports and airflow and ventilation. So obviously you have to go through an airport to get on an airplane. So, you know, I believe everybody should be wearing masks. Airplanes really have to put a lot of effort, I think, into trying to, or airlines, to make make airports safer. But once you get on an airplane, the airflow is actually quite good. Especially, I think, if airlines can get into doing some testing and making sure that they're testing people with some frequency before people get on planes. I think flying will be reasonably safe. I may be one of the few public health people who feel that way, but certainly the act of flying, I think, itself is pretty safe from a coronavirus point of view.
We know you're just saying that so that you have a lot of legroom on the flights that you're on for your job.
That's
right. You know what that's. W. David on Facebook asks, can I go outside to parks and to the beach?
Yes, you should. Well, here's what we know. I think the transmission outside is much, much lower than the transmission inside. So in general, I've been encouraging people to get out, go to the park, go to the beach. My parents are elderly. They're in New Jersey. They've been pretty locked up. I've been telling them to go out to the parks. The issue is you don't want to go out to super crowded parks or super crowded beaches where everybody's kind of shoulder to shoulder. So if you can maintain social distance, if you're worried, if you have health problems, you should be wearing a mask. And personally, I'd like it if other people wore masks too, even out in public. But if you can maintain social distance, parks and beaches are great places to be, and you can stay pretty safe.
And they're also good, as we know, for people's mental health. And it's just important to break that routine and to get some fresh air. And as you were saying before, in an environment where the outside atmosphere is where the virus might be circulating, being out in the breeze is a lot better than being inside in a cooped up locale. A couple of other questions. Ashish, this is so great having you here. Thank you for doing all of these. John Lundevall on Facebook asks, are they continuing to track influenza type illnesses through the summer? These may help foresee when and if spreading a virus reemerges in regions and across the country. Do we track flu all through the summer?
We have a pretty vigorous influenza surveillance program that I'm pretty sure lasts all year. I don't think it's only, obviously the number of cases dropped dramatically in the summer. But I think this summer into the fall, we're going to have a much more robust surveillance program because we're going to want to catch any increases in COVID much earlier. And I believe that part of it shouldn't just be symptom checking, which is a big part of that surveillance, but we should be doing pretty vigorous testing as a part of tracing the reemergence of COVID, which will almost surely happen in a big way this fall.
Almost surely. You're confident about that.
I am. It's hard for me. Two things. I mean, first of all, the virus isn't going away. You know, I often say that if this is a 9-inning baseball game, we're in the top of the 3rd inning right now. We have a long way to go. And if the summer is beneficial because of seasonality and warm weather helps us, then the fall and winter will be really harmful because all of the benefits that we got from the summer will be the detriments in the fall and winter. So I do expect a reasonably big wave in the fall and winter, and it'll coincide with the flu season, which will already stretch hospitals. It's going to be a tough period of time. And our job is really to figure out how to get ready for it and get through it in a way that keeps America safe.
I want to ask you one question that is, it's a little bit of public health and it's a little bit of politics. We put out a poll recently with the NPR, Marist, and PBS NewsHour, and it was asking people about their views about reopening, when it would happen, when they would personally feel comfortable doing it. And the thing that was so striking about it is that a large number of people are still uncertain about it. They're nervous about going back out and reopening of their city or their state. But that there also was an incredible partisan divide in that Republicans believed that things were going to be much better sooner. Democrats were much more likely to believe that things will take longer to get better. Does that make sense to you, knowing how information is communicated and how people are digesting the information from people like yourself?
Yeah, it does make some sense. My sense is that overall Americans have been much more on the same page about things like the value of staying at home, the value of more testing. But we do see some divergence in a few areas. And I think some of it is driven by political leadership. You know, you've heard from the president this idea that the virus might just go away even without a vaccine, that the worst is behind us. And, you know, if you're a Republican who looks to the president for information and guidance, You know, a lot of Democrats did with President Obama, right? So it makes some sense that Republicans would do that. Then they're going to likely listen to that. And I think that has created some amount of the partisan divide. At the end of the day, the science is going to be the science, whether you believe it or not. And all of the science and all of the data says we're in early days. We are not done with this virus. We might get a little reprieve over the summer, but we still have a ways to go.
This has been so helpful having you here. Dr. Ashish Jha, the director of the Harvard Global Health Institute. Thank you very, very much for being here and answering all these varied questions. It's a pleasure to see you and have you back on again. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks for having me on, Ray.
And to everyone who's been watching, thank you for your questions. This has really been an interesting and wide-ranging series of very, very smart questions. Thank you for joining us. I'm William Brangham of the PBS NewsHour. Thanks for tuning in.